Take it back. I don't want it. I'm done.
Don't do this to me, Tom.
I'm buying a Tesla. I'm ordering a Cybertruck. You're out.
It's the flashlight that did us in.
Hey guys, it's delivery day for my Rivian R1S. Those of you that follow the channel know that I had a Rivian R1T. I actually ordered an R1T and an R1S long time ago. I got the R1T first, but I figured the R1S is gonna be a better fit for my family because I already have a pickup truck, the Ford F-150 Lightning. I don't need two electric pickup trucks. So I sold the R1T to a good friend of mine. I'm taking delivery of the R1S today. Now, Rivian offers home delivery service because they don't have dealerships. You can elect to pick your vehicle up at a service center. The closest service center to me is in New York. It's like 55 miles away in Brooklyn. It's really not convenient for me to go there and pick it up. So they offer home delivery service. And like the R1T, I'm having the R1S delivered to my home. Now, if you follow this channel, you may have seen a video I did on my R1T home delivery where the person, Sade, the delivery specialist, did an awesome job explaining the whole vehicle to me, showing me how to set it up, all its features. And the video did actually very well. People were very engaged and liked it. So I figured I'd do it again now with the R1S. Now, unfortunately, we don't have Sade as my delivery specialist. We have another gentleman coming, his name's Anthony. Now I did check with Rivian to see if it was okay to record this and have Anthony do everything on camera, show me how, you know, you take delivery of a Rivian. The point of this isn't for me to get any kind of special treatment because I'm a journalist and I run State of Charge. I mean, that's probably gonna happen. There's no way you can get around it, but I basically asked, give me the basic delivery service that you do for everybody. Explain all the features. Now I know I understand a lot of how the Rivian works, the infotainment system, all that stuff's the same as the R1T. But we're gonna treat this as if I don't know anything about it and have Anthony go over all the different features in the truck. So that way those that may be getting ready for an upcoming R1S delivery will know what to expect. So I'm standing outside of my porch. We're supposed to have delivery at 11 a.m. It's 10:55 now. The truck should be pulling up any minute. So let's see how this goes. We're gonna cut back in once the truck is here. And perfectly on time, Anthony is pulling up. Way it works is they deliver the vehicles on a flatbed. They don't drive them to your house. I thought maybe that's how they did it the first time and then like Uber back to the service center, but no, they flatbed them up. And here she comes. I got the R1S in the same color combo that I had my R1T. The forest green with Ocean Coast interior. I love that interior. Looking good. All righty. Let's go over and see what Anthony has to say. Hopefully Rivian has let him know that I'm going to be doing this and he's okay with doing this on camera. You should be Anthony, correct?
I'm Anthony.
Anthony, how are you?
I'm great.
My name is Tom. I hope Rivian told you that I was planning on recording this whole thing, making a video. Okay, we could tell from Anthony's expression, he knows this is gonna happen, so it's gonna happen. And I wanna thank you for agreeing to participate in it. Now, I've done this before, I had the R1T. I know before we do anything, you're gonna unload this guy, and then we're going to sign some papers.
Gotta sign the papers.
We don't need to get that on camera, but I'm gonna let you take the R1S off, maybe get the truck out of the way so we can do this recording up here.
Great.
And then I'll go and sign the docs and we'll get going.
Let's do it.
Thank you.
Cool.
There's my Lightning, and how's that for a garage? I don't own the Mustang Mach-E. I actually have it on loan this week from Ford because it has the new Blue Cruise 1.2, and I'm doing some content on that and seeing how good the new Blue Cruise system is. All right, let's let Anthony unload this guy, and we'll get on with it.
This video is powered by QMerit, North America's leading provider of installation services for electric vehicle charging, home energy storage, and other electrification technologies. See how QMerit is making the energy transition easy for home and business owners by following the link in the description of this video. So Anthony then carefully lowered the R1S off the flatbed. We then had to move it around a little bit so we could get the flatbed out of the way and pull it down the driveway. We then went inside, and as I said, we have to sign some paperwork before the vehicle is officially mine. Once that was done, we headed outside to check out the vehicle and give Anthony the opportunity to explain all the features to me.
Okay. Congratulations. Right. Thanks for being a part of the family.
Thank you. Well, I've been part of the family for a little bit. Yeah, right. I'm again. So this is the Rivian vehicles come with one physical key and two key cards.
That's correct.
So this is what you're handing me now because we signed the paperwork. And now
and it's yours.
Yeah, it's my vehicle. It's, all right.
There you go.
All right. Well, we're going to pair it with the app and everything later once we get inside the truck. But for now, I would assume I want you to do this like you would do it for anybody. Now, one thing I want to let people know is that most people take delivery at the delivery service centers. They can't wait to get their car. As soon as it's in, they drive there and pick it up. But if you have a circumstance where you can't go or you prefer home delivery, you can arrange for that. And that's what we did here today. I live like 60 miles from the Brooklyn service center. It's the closest one to me. And to be honest with you, it's a pain in the butt for me to get there from here. So yeah. I'm way out northern New Jersey. So that's why I elect to have these. And also to do these recordings, which makes it good for me to show my audience. All right, so I own the truck now. I want you to do a typical delivery. You know, if somebody buys a car at a dealership, the salesperson, after they've told them about the car they purchased, they show them the features. You don't have dealership, so let's see. How do you explain the truck to people?
Right, you gotta get on board. You gotta know what's going on here. So the first thing I like to do is show them the storage in the front.
Okay.
Because it is, you know, something they got to get used to where to put their groceries. They go in the front now. Mm-hmm. I mean, you could put them in the back, we'll get there, but this is where a lot of people put their gear. So the way to open the front trunk is right under here. Go ahead and feel the rubber button there.
Yep.
And press it right there. And of course, we got to make sure it's unlocked. So if it's unlocked, you just hold it for an extra second.
Duh, I'm a R1T owner and I didn't hold it long enough.
Well, this is a good point because you may have been used to opening it maybe from your screen. You may have been opening it from your key fob. You can open it from your app.
I usually opened it from the app because I'm carrying stuff walking up, but I have opened it from there. I just blew that one. I didn't press it long enough.
No, it's good. It's good. Everybody likes an authentic blooper every once in a while. So this is your front trunk.
Uh-huh.
It's got a lot of space for your groceries, for your gear, whatever you may be doing. Mm-hmm. And there is a little rope in here that kind of reveals a deeper layer.
Yep.
So if you notice, the magnet goes up against the back wall.
Mm-hmm.
And now you've got a deeper layer here.
And this can lift out, I believe,
That's
right?
correct. Yeah, just lift it right up.
Yeah, it pops out. This is like a false floor that's in the bottom of the frunk. And if you really just want to have a lot of volume, you can take it out.
Exactly.
Let's put it back in.
Exactly. Perfect. By the way,
what's this?
This is a goodie bag. It's a portable charger.
Okay.
So in case you're not at home to charge or in case you're not near a public charging station, you've got your own portable charger that you can plug right from your vehicle to a wall outlet, a regular wall outlet. And there's also an adapter in there if you have access to a washer dryer outlet.
Okay.
Like a 240 volt.
240. So it's a 120 and 240 volt charger. It's a dual voltage charger, we call these, which is good because you never know where you're going to be and have the need to opportunity charge. You can plug this into either a regular household outlet or if you find a NEMA 1450 240 volt outlet.
Exactly. Okay. You want to feel covered.
Yep.
So no matter your situation, you've got a charging access.
The window sticker, which isn't a sticker, it's just a piece of paper. So yeah. Oh, don't remind me how much I paid for this. But it's worth it. It's a great vehicle.
I think And for the families out there who have little ones that may want to play hide and seek in the front trunk, our CEO has two little ones as well, and he installed a glow-in-the-dark escape hatch button.
You press that.
So that if anyone accidentally gets stuck in there, you can get out with a little button in there.
Well, this is New Jersey, and we kind of have a reputation of putting people in the trunk.
I don't know anything about it. I don't.
So I would ever do that. So there's also a up in the front here, same as my R1T. It looks, it's probably exactly the same size and everything's
R1T. It is literally the exact same.
There's a mesh bag in the front here that has, I guess, the front license plate holder. I told Rivian not to install it. I'll do that later. And then also the child seat lower anchors for the back.
That's right. Yeah. If you use child seats, these little guys make them easier to latch in.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Okay.
All right, so we're done with the front?
Yep, we can close it automatically using the same exact button.
Okay.
There's the front trunk.
Very good. So what do we look at next?
One thing I like to show with the Rivian is the second row.
Okay.
Now, whenever you would like to, we can also talk about the front charge port.
Okay, we'll do that. Let's go this way around the vehicle.
And we'll finish at the charge port.
Yeah, we'll finish up over there.
Cool, so the second row.
Okay, Anthony, so we've got the back doors open. This is the second row seating.
This is your second row. Now, obviously, you know the R1S has a third row. So in order to get to the third row, you have a shoulder button on either side. You just press it once, and now I can get to the third row. So you just take one step up, and I'm in the third row. Now, before you get to the third row, you may want to adjust the second row.
So one second, I noticed when you push that seat back, it didn't go all the way back.
Yep. It just kind of locks into place. If you want to go farther forward or back or farther forward, you have the bar underneath here. So if I lift that bar, I can then slide it on its track forward and backward. Okay. Same with the recline. You also have a lever, and you can see it on your side outside there. There's a little lever that you lift to recline the vehicle, to recline the seats. So just like that. Yep. Perfect, and that'll throw it flat.
Yeah.
So you can either go recline or you can let it all go.
Okay.
And now you've got the adjustable second row.
Yeah, so we're gonna check in a second though, does this go flat with the third row seats when you put those down? Because
you betcha.
This is very flat. A lot of times when you see hatchbacks or cars that say flat folding and you get in there and it's like this and they're like, yeah, it's flat folding.
You're like, give me a break.
Yeah, so this is flat and the third row is flat. Yeah.
There's, we'll see back there, there's a slight drop off, but we have a flattener, I guess you could say. I'll show you that when we get back there.
Okay, so are we done here? Are we going to the back
Yeah,
now?
The only thing you need to know is that these second rows slide forward and backward as well as recline.
Yeah.
And then you can get to the third row, no problem.
Okay, excellent. Let's take a look at the third row.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm not 100% sold yet on the third row having enough leg room once somebody's sitting in the second row. How tall are you?
5'10".
All right, so I'm 5'8", so you're taller than me. I want you to sit back there, and then I'm gonna sit in the second row and adjust the seats to make it comfortable for me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Seems like you fit.
Yep.
Let me get in here, and I'm going to move the seat up because I'm not going to give myself a ton of leg room, just enough to give you some. Now I'm going to put my seat back because it's really... Okay,
yeah.
So let's see your legs back here.
Yeah,
you're touching? No, you're not touching. It's close, but you're not touching.
That looks I'm reclined a little bit. You know, I could even get a little bit more upright to give myself more space.
And I honestly could go a little closer. If you were taller, I could sit here like this just fine. And you know what? We didn't even... factor in the fact that we didn't adjust the front seats. They look like they could go up more up forward too. So
that's the whole point. You got a first row and a second row that is adjustable.
Yeah.
So even though the third row is static, the first and second row folks can help.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure this seat can go further up unless it was somebody really tall in the front even give a little bit more room. So, but this is great. I could do a road trip like this. It looks like you could fit back there also.
I'm feeling good.
All right, let's take a look at the back.
Okay. So to undo the second row, just press the shoulder button right here once, and now I can get out.
Beautiful. All right, so we're around back of the vehicle now. Show me how this all works.
This all works with a split gate. So underneath the V is your button. Just press it once and let it go.
You didn't have to hold it like I had to hold the front as much, I think. You're cheating on me over here.
I think you'll get used to it.
All right.
It's pretty easy. And then you got your tailgate.
Yep.
All you gotta do is press this here and it comes right down.
Okay.
Okay. So this is your opening. It's pretty...
It's not a power lift gate, right?
That's correct. Yeah. It's a manual.
Manual, okay.
Now this top one is power.
Yeah, that comes up and down.
Automatic there. This is your cargo room behind the third row.
Okay.
It's a good amount of cargo room for, again, any gear, groceries, whatever you may need.
Looks like it's about 20 inches from here to the back seat about. And this is here like
a... This is going to actually stay there because we're going to, it's kind of a lip that we're going to make a flat surface out of. So I'll show you that.
I'll let you do your thing.
Yeah. This is obviously for just any extra room you may need if you want to sit.
It's carpeted, yeah.
It's carpeted. Yeah. And I'll show you a little bit over here. We have a wall outlet if you want to plug in a refrigerator or any sort of extra fun stuff. You could enjoy some beverages.
Now here's a technical question. How much can it put out? Do you know?
It has 1,500 watts of power.
So it's 1.5 kilowatt. Yeah. Okay. So you're good on you. You know it. That's fine. That can power almost anything that you would plug into a regular 120 volt outlet, because most circuits at home are only 15 amp circuits. So.
Okay. Okay. So let's talk about the third row. You can throw the third row down. Yeah. A lot of people, if they're not hauling folks in the third row 100% of the time, they flatten it, mm-hmm. maybe to get some extra cargo space, right? Mm-hmm. So how to fold the third row? Shoulder strap mm-hmm. or shoulder latch.
Yeah.
Lift the shoulder latch and throw it down.
Okay. All right. So lift it up and push it down. All right.
Okay. So now you have this pseudo flat surface.
Yeah. But it's not as flat as you were saying before.
Right. We're going to make sure that fixes. Right. We're going to fix that. So there's a lip right here. Yeah. Take the floorboard.
It's about 3 inches, by the way, it looks like. There's mm-hmm. a lip where the lower section's about 3 inches lower than where the rear seat folded down, the
right.
third row seat folded down.
We thought about that, mm-hmm. right? We know that when people are loading suitcases or when they want to sleep in their vehicle, yeah. you want a flat surface. Mm-hmm. So you can take this floorboard mm-hmm. and put it right on this lip mm-hmm. for a flat surface.
Okay. Well, it's ramped down, but it yeah. is flat, but it ramps down a little bit.
It's a yeah. little ramp. Yeah. And you know, when folks put like a little air mattress on mm-hmm. there and everything, you're not going to feel that.
Yeah,
you
no,
can see the stars through the window.
Uh-huh.
And so that's what people like about this, obviously. So that's that.
Yeah. The panoramic glass roof in the R1S is in two pieces. In the R1T, it's just one giant roof. But since this has the rear section, it looks like that front glass panel is about the same size as the R1T was. But then there's a crossbar and then a second, roof glass.
That's
roof
right, a glass
here.
Window. Yeah. There's two. Mm-hmm. So those third row passengers get really, you know, yeah.
their own little connection
to the outdoors.
Yeah.
And the roof has three crossbar sockets.
Mm-hmm.
So you can install the two crossbars if you were to buy those from our gear shop. Mm-hmm. They have three sockets for you.
Okay, excellent. So now this looked like there was a lower section under here.
Yeah, so underneath your floorboard, mm-hmm. We can actually just kind of remove it
okay.
easily, and you've got a couple bags here. This mm-hmm. is your compressor bag.
Yep.
It's a hose to go from your compressor,
yep.
which I'll show you in a moment, to the bike
yep.
or to the tire if you want to mm-hmm. inflate or deflate your own tires. You don't have to go anywhere for air.
And that's a question that I've been getting now on my channel, was everybody knows the R1T has the built-in air compressor. It's a truck, and you know, of course you'd want that to air down your tires and everything, but what I think a lot of people don't realize, the R1S comes with it also. So, you know, I think they assumed, well, it's SUV, it doesn't have that feature, but
right.
it does. So,
it totally
yeah.
does.
And this is where you keep the hose and kit. In the R1T, this is kept in the gear tunnel door.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
And so, you know, just for folks, I do like to mm-hmm. show this
yep.
So people know what they can inflate and deflate.
Mm-hmm.
You've obviously got the hose.
Mm-hmm.
So that goes into your valve and then connects to your item.
Mm-hmm.
But then in these little pouches, you've got the key.
Mm-hmm.
This is the key that actually attaches to your hose.
Yep.
And from this key, you can put any adapter that you might okay. want. We give you some in this other pouch. We give you the, you know,
yep.
basketball, the bicycle,
yeah.
the raft.
Yeah. Okay.
Anything you may need to inflate.
Yeah. So I'm going to be testing this out, because one of the things I noticed on my R1T, it has difficulty stopping at the set point. A lot of times I set it to the 48 pounds per square inch, because that's what the R1T tires are. I think these are the same. I'm not sure. And I'm pumping air after I air down. And I'm like, God, this is taking a long time. So I took it off and put my tire gauge on. And it said 56 pounds per square inch. It didn't stop at 48. So I'm going to see if this one works. And it happened more than once on the R1T. So
something you may want to do. Yeah, yeah. Just make sure that whenever you set it to the desired PSI,
yeah. Maybe. I had it set right.
I was going to say.
It wasn't working
maybe
right.
Maybe as you get closer. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
As you maybe get closer, check it periodically
yeah.
as you get closer.
I'm not here to
We're going to try to dial
this.
In.
It's just,
yeah, yeah.
I noticed that, since we're talking about it, I noticed that with my R1T, and I'm going to test it with this. I might have just gotten a faulty one or whatever, and I should have brought it back to service and had them look at it, but I've just been busy and haven't had it. I told the person who I sold it to, because I just sold the R1T in order to pay for the R1S, that is an issue, and he's going to probably have it checked out. But anyway,
yeah,
let's not sidetrack this. I just, it was a sidebar, because I, I remember that it wasn't working.
No, that's helpful.
It did work though. I mean, it pumped up the tire. It just didn't stop at the set point.
Yeah, you can pump up the tire. You can deflate the tire, right? For off-roading purposes, some people like to do that. This is also coming in the bag. Mm-hmm. And this is a tire patch kit.
Yep.
Okay, so if you elect to buy a spare tire, then you've got that under here. If you don't, which, you know, some people don't, you've got a spare tire patch kit. Yeah.
Which, you know, kind of works, this stuff, but anybody who's used this goop before knows it can be a painful process if you don't do it exactly right. You could end up with stuff on your hands that you don't want to have to deal with. It's getting out the turpentine to get it off.
Yeah,
in any event.
It's like a solution,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, so that's emergency. Use that inflatable tire stuff if you need to. In other circumstances, use the other alternative.
Right.
So very cool.
And there's roadside assistance.
This looks like this lifts out. Wow.
That's right.
Yeah.
Underneath your bags.
Let's lift this up.
You've got, take it right on out.
Yeah. And so, and there's a first aid kit on the other side also. So now it's even a lower section.
Yeah. So a lot of people use that for storage.
Yep.
And of course, that's where your spare tire would go if you bought one.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've got two little tracks here, silver tracks. These are tie downs. Mm-hmm. So if you lift that little hook there, you can even slide it along the track.
You press a button and slide it.
That's right.
And as soon as you lift up the button, it locks into place.
It locks right into place.
Okay. So some people, set points, like every, seems like every inch or so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it snaps in. Very good.
It's frequent.
Yeah.
You know, some people like to tie down their cargo.
Yeah.
Extra security, whatever it may be. That's always there.
Yep. That works.
All right, so now I think it's good to show you the how to throw down that second row and your wall outlet over here.
Very cool.
So I'll put this back into place on our little ramp.
All right.
And then I'll come over here.
Okay, let me move around here. All righty, let's roll.
Yeah. So you've got two panels here, one up top, one at the bottom. The bottom one is your compressor. So you can see you've got a plus, a minus, and a play. So you just kind of set your desired PSI and you press play. And you can feel the air coming out.
Yep.
So that's all good. And so that's how that works. Up here, you've got a couple things, a wall outlet, a 12 volt outlet, just for your rear electronics. And then you've got two buttons here that throw the second row down.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to throw the third row down, you do that with the shoulder strap.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to throw the second row down, just go ahead and tap one of these buttons.
Come over here and move this a little bit. You could tap it.
Okay.
All right. Beautiful. And now we could see we've got this long, flat surface. And I mean, this is, as I said, this ramps up a little bit, but you don't even notice it. Like if you were laying here, you really wouldn't know that it wasn't completely flat. That's awesome. Do you happen to know what the dimensions are in between these two?
Not off the top of my head.
Okay.
But
I had to
I can get that
something.
For you. Yeah.
No, I had to ask you a question you couldn't answer while we're here.
And it's nice because on the outside, it doesn't look massive.
Yeah.
It's got a sleek look from the outside, but on the inside,
yeah.
The cargo room in here is outstanding.
And while we're here, I am going to measure this on camera.
Great.
Because I want to show people exactly what the width is in between so they know what it can fit.
Let's do it.
All right. So I'm back with a measuring tape. Let's see what this width is here. It is, I gotta climb up. So from here to here, you've got 42 and a half inches. So, well actually 42 and a quarter. So there's 42 and a quarter inches in between the two third row armrests. So, and going forward, I just wanna see what you have from the seat to here. The way we have the seats set now, there's 86 inches to the point here where the rear cargo tailgate will lift up. So that's long. Lots of room in the back of this.
You want to go height?
Yeah, might as well. Let's do the opening. The opening here is 30 and 3/4 inches is what I'm getting from right here. Yeah. But as you go up, because it ramps up, let me do the smallest point. The smallest point here is 28 and 3/4 inch. So you would need that to be able to get a box going through there. So, but this could fit, you know, the biggest, you know, LED TV that you'd want and probably a lot of other things. I might have to do charger box test and see how many boxes of chargers I can fit back here.
Yeah, well, you've got plenty. I was just in your garage and it's loaded.
Do you know the cargo capacity of back here?
Off the cubic feet of storage, off the top of my head.
Okay, that's fine. I'll provide that in the video. So,
okay.
You know, I can't let you answer every question.
I appreciate it.
You can't.
I gotta go review my stats, my specs.
Okay, so anything else back here we need to talk about?
No, I think we're good. Maybe one thing, just the third row folks get an armrest.
Yep.
So you can lift that.
Oh, that's nice.
And if you'd like to.
These lift up and there's storage in there. And I see there's USB-C. Ports inside of those on both sides and cup holders.
Yep.
So very cool.
We're not leaving the third row passengers hanging.
Yeah, very cool.
And they do have their own climate as well, specifically for them, which when we get to the climate control on the screen, you can see
you can control it. Do they get to control it or you do it up front?
You do it up front
and
they live by your rule.
Okay, as it should be. All right, let's, I assume that's it for back here. Let's maybe, well, let's go look at the charge port and then we'll, go inside the vehicle and look at the infotainment system.
Let's look at it.
Awesome.
All right. Do you want to close that?
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so the charge port for the all Rivian vehicles is all the way up here in the front corner of the vehicle, and it's a power-operated charge port. Why don't you explain how that opens and everything we need to know
There's
about
three
it.
Little lines on this black panel here.
Yep.
You just place your thumb on those to open. Mm-hmm. And you can also open this from your screen. You can open it from your app.
Yeah.
But that's typically the easiest way since you're already kind of out here getting the plug.
Absolutely. And one thing I want to point out is I had my Rivian R1T through the winter, and I was concerned that this would freeze over and it wouldn't pop open, but it never happened to me. And I had some mornings where everything was iced up pretty good, but it was able to crack it and push the ice out and pop it open.
You had to make sure that gear was strong enough.
Yeah.
And we've done significant winter testing. Yeah. Obviously, we encourage people to go into the wild with these, including like the Canadian and upper Minnesota. Yeah.
It's an adventure vehicle.
Of course.
It better open up when it's
This is how
frozen.
You power it. So it's very important to get access to it.
Yeah.
Now, the charge port in here is a J1772. This is a standard charge port you're going to find at, most every single charging station has that standard charge port. This is compatible with that. Of course,
I thought the NACS was the standard, North American Charging Standard. That's Tesla's connector.
Oh, I didn't even know that was called Tesla. So
here's why you don't know. Just recently, Tesla decided to name their connector and call it the NACS, the North American Charging Standard. And I guess they believed that by calling something a standard, it was going to make it a standard. But I don't necessarily agree with that. I know some Tesla faithful do and say it's the standard because there's more Teslas than anything else, which there is. There's way more Teslas than everything else combined. But calling something the standard isn't. They're the only company that uses it. Aptera may use it if they ever bring their vehicle to market, but they don't use it yet. So every electric vehicle sold in North America uses the J1772 port for level one and level two charging, 120 volt and 240 volt. So I just want to straighten that out right now, and then we'll talk about the DC fast charging.
You're the charging expert.
I can't let somebody talk about charging and not jump in.
That's right. This is good. I'm glad. You might see CHAdeMO plugs, but those I believe are being retired. So if, I think only maybe one manufacturer might use those and those are being retired. So really this is the most, all the charging stations that are popping up.
Yeah. Other than Tesla superchargers.
Of course, Tesla superchargers have their own plug.
Yeah.
Now, I believe there's been some press recently that they've released that allows other non-Tesla vehicles to visit those stations. I don't know which exact stations those are.
There's about 10 in the country right now, and they're going to proliferate later on. But as of now, you have to pretty much bank on if you don't have a Tesla vehicle, you can't use a supercharger unless you happen to find one of the 10 or 15 that are currently opening. So, this is going to be an evolving thing over the next year.
It's evolving. Everything's evolving, right? There's tons of chargers popping up. And in your screen, you'll be able to see all the chargers that are compatible with this vehicle.
Just with this vehicle.
You can navigate right to it.
Yeah, which, talking about, it's interesting. And I know it works because I've had my R1T and I see it's compatible. I was just driving the Ford Mustang Mach-E. I have it on loan from Ford, and their in-car navigation will navigate you to charging stations. So I hit it to see what was around, and it was navigating me to Tesla superchargers.
Okay.
And they weren't ones that are compatible to CCS. So Ford's got to get that a little bit straightened out. The Rivian system does work, at least in my, what I've seen so far, it only will navigate you to stations that have CCS or J1772.
Yeah, and again, it is an evolving thing because I believe that there might now be some visibility into Tesla. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much or whatever. That's our software team who kind of tracks
They'll
all that.
They'll probably make it, have the Tesla stations that have this, they call it the magic dock, that it'll charge CCS vehicles. They're probably integrating that in and just picking, cherry picking the supercharger sites that can charge CCS.
Yeah. So, all right, look. Okay, so it closed automatically because it was just going to sleep.
Yeah,
you just place your thumb back on those three lines to open and close it. The only other thing I wanted to say was there is a flap. If you drop that flap, that allows you to, you know,
CCS
fast
pens.
Charge.
Yeah, those are the two CCS fast charging pens.
And those will be just a bigger plug.
Yep.
You'll see the station is a little bit bigger and it charges your vehicle a lot faster. Mm-hmm. And of course, you can identify which ones are fast charging and slower charging on your screen.
Yeah, that's good. We'll go over that when we go inside. I like that feature. And you can even filter out which level, how fast of a charging station you want the system to set to show you.
Right.
So you could say, I don't want level two chargers. Show me all the DC fast chargers. Now show me all the really fast DC fast chargers.
Has two levels
of speed. We'll do that once we get hop inside.
Cool.
Okay.
So to close it, and again, it's really simple, same exact thing. Yeah.
And I also know that when you put it in drive, like if you unplug your vehicle and then, you know, dock the connector and then you don't close it, you get back in the vehicle and turn, and as soon as you turn the vehicle on or as soon as you put it in drive, it closes.
Yep.
So you can't drive off with the charge port open. That's not the case with a lot of electric vehicles. A lot of electric vehicles don't have power operated charge port doors. So if you don't close the flap, it stays open. And there's been, I know people that have driven away with their charge flap open and in the rain, and they had a lot of problems because the inside the charge port just got soaked.
Mm.
So it's very good. I like to see this. And if the EV doesn't have this automatic closing charge port door, because that adds cost to the vehicle, I understand why a lot of vehicles don't have that. There should at least be a notification on the driver's screen that says charge flap open. So and then you get out and you close it. A lot of EVs don't have that. It just stays open. You don't know. So anyway, good on Rivian. I like this whole design here. I like how it works. I've been using it for 8 months now with my R1T, and it's a very good functioning charge port.
There's nothing wrong with a little pizzazz. You know, you get a little bit of oohs and ahs, especially if you got young ones who show it off to their friends. You know, it's a cool little magic trick.
Yeah, the only thing, and this is another question I might stump you with, do you know if there's a manual opener for this? Because let's say it broke or, you know, the 12-volt battery's dead. Can you open that?
Our service advisor would be the guy to talk to about that. Yeah,
right.
I don't want to give the wrong answer, so I would definitely defer to them.
Okay,
our service team. I've never heard of that coming in. I'm on the delivery team.
Yeah,
so I've never heard of a malfunctioning charge port door. But it's a fair question.
These are all new now.
Yeah,
4 or 5 years down the road, things start breaking.
Right.
You know. Hopefully, there's a way to pop that open.
I've always been impressed by our whole design team and how thoughtful they are, so I can't imagine this slipped past them.
Okay.
I'm sure there's a solution. I don't have the verified.
Okay, and I should even know that. I should have looked into this in the past. It just happened to be coming up with me right now as we're talking.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that does it for the exterior
walk around. That's the exterior, yeah.
Okay, let's, there's one thing that I wanna take a look at around here. I'm sure this has the flashlight built into the door. So let's take a quick look at that before we hop in the vehicle to do the interior walk.
Okay.
All right. Okay, so one of the things that I love about the Rivian, it's the little things that matters, is there's a flashlight, an LED flashlight that's tucked into the driver's door, and it's always charging, so it's always ready when you need it.
It's a flashlight.
And it uses the same battery. Well, I'll let you say this.
It's good. I like when you say it.
It uses the same battery cells that Rivian uses in their battery pack, and the Rivian battery pack uses 7,776 battery cells. And when you add the one for the flashlight, Rivian vehicles, this is for the large pack, because they're going to have a max pack and a smaller pack. But right now, they just started launching the max pack, I think.
We just started producing the max pack. But for this one, this is our large pack.
The large pack. So including the flashlight, it has 7,777 batteries used in this pack.
This is a fun fact.
Yeah, so let's check it out.
Yeah, so it's right here in the door.
Ooh.
Yeah.
You forgot my flashlight.
You know what? I thought I'd throw in a little surprise for you and the audience. No, honestly, this is supposed to be here. Tom.
This isn't getting cut out. This is going to make the video.
I understand. No, it should. Here's how this works. We do
take it back. I don't want it. I'm done.
Don't do this to me, Tom.
I'm buying a Tesla. I'm ordering a Cybertruck. You're out.
It's the flashlight that did us in. I really apologize.
This wasn't staged.
I really apologize. Listen, here's how this works. I'll bring you a flashlight.
You have to bring it to me. Put it in the mail and mail it to me.
We'll make sure you get a flashlight.
Just drop it in a box, but I want my flashlight.
Oh, you will definitely get a flashlight.
And if tonight...
And a sincere written apology from me personally.
From you? How about from RJ?
Well, here's
Hey, RJ, what's going on with this?
Our team
Don't you know who I am?
I think he does, actually. No.
Yeah, we have met, by the way. He's a cool guy.
Yeah.
But, I want my flashlight. And if tonight, if I break down somewhere in a really bad area and I get out of the truck and I'm stumbling to do something and I trip and fall, you're getting sued.
This is bad.
I might sue you personally, in addition to Rivian, because you should have checked that before you came.
Well, yeah, so that's what I was going to say. Oh, my gosh. She's giving me the business. I understand.
All right. No biggie. Just drop it in the box.
We do a big, pre-delivery check. Yeah. And so our team, may have...
They missed it.
Who knows? I don't necessarily want to come up with an explanation, but we'll make sure you get it.
I want someone fired. Fire that person. No, I don't. Not at all. People make mistakes. Everybody's, that's something that's really can happen. You guys right now are ramping up deliveries. I know because I report on this stuff.
Yeah.
You're pushing them out the door as fast as you can. Listen, that's nothing. No, don't worry about it.
But definitely include it in the video. It's...
It's not getting cut out.
This is real life.
We don't hide anything here at State of Charge. So, okay. All right, well...
But that's where the flashlight would be.
We were going to see the flashlight, but...
This is how it works. Just use your imagination, right? You push in, it comes out.
I'll use B-roll from my R1T flashlight, just so everybody knows what it looks like.
It's the same exact one.
Even the door's the same. We almost could have done this and not let people know, because this part of the vehicle looks exactly the same.
It's your same color, right? It's the same interior.
I could have used Sade's clip where she showed it. People are like, wait a minute. How'd that happen?
Got a substitute for the moment.
All right. Let's jump inside. We beat this dead horse too much already. But this is what happens. It's not perfect. But as long as everything else is fine, I guess I'll keep it. Let's hop inside and check it out.
Okay.
To my surprise, about 2 hours after Anthony left, another Rivian associate pulled up to my house with the flashlight in a box. I'd like to think every customer would get this type of white glove treatment, but I'm guessing it probably had something to do with who I am. Hopefully that's not the case, though. In any event, I got my flashlight.
All right, Anthony, we're inside the R1S. We're going to go over the infotainment system, act like I have no idea. I've never seen a Rivian. Show me how this all works.
Absolutely. So this is our welcome sequence. This has a quick process to set you up with your phone key and your Bluetooth. Make sure you're connected to your Wi-Fi. So let's go through that real quick, and then we'll go through the actual experience on a day-to-day basis.
That works.
Good morning, Thomas. Good morning.
It's got my name already keyed in. That's because I paired it with my phone earlier.
That's right.
So that's why it knows me.
Once you officially accepted it, it kind of transferred that and initiated this sequence. So press let's go and get comfy. So obviously we want to make sure you're comfortable in your seat, your driving position, press continue.
Yep.
And then to make sure you're safe with your mirrors, you can press your name and then tap steering wheel. Yep. And then you'll use the scrollers on your steering wheel to sort of adjust the height and the telescoping with the left one.
The right one does the height. The left one does the telescoping. All right, I'll push that away. I'll set that up later.
Yep. Whatever you like.
And then you would hit remember.
You would hit remember.
Yeah. Well, then you would do side mirrors.
Side mirrors.
You adjust
those
the same way. The right one does the right mirror. The left one does the
Timed out. So tap it again.
Yeah.
There you go.
And the left one does the left mirror up and down. Okay.
Yeah. And the buttons next to the scrollers. Go the left and the right.
Left and right. Yeah, move it in and out. Very, very cool. Okay.
Very nice. Continue and remember.
Continue and now hit remember. I'll set that up later.
So now we're going to add your phone as a key.
Okay.
All right. So go ahead and go into your Rivian app.
Doing that now.
And it should prompt you to swipe up to add the key.
Okay. It says, 1 second. Let's set up the key. Begin setup. Right.
There you go.
All right.
Add your phone as a key by swiping up.
All right.
Nice. And that should be sending a signal to your screen here.
Preparing the connection.
And in a moment, it should prompt you to pair from your phone.
Okay, allow it to pair, allowing.
Okay, it's ready. So I'll go ahead and press setup now. It recognizes your phone here. It's just sending a signal and then it pairs it to it.
Okay. Your phone is now a key.
There you go.
So now my wife is going to drive the vehicle also. This was simple because it was forcing me to set it up before we get going. Could you maybe show us?
I definitely
how
will.
To do, well, you don't have to do it right
Once
now,
we
but
get in.
Yeah, let's do it. Okay.
Absolutely.
So now continue.
Uh-huh. And now you use Bluetooth.
Yes.
All right, so let's quickly go to your Bluetooth settings in your phone.
Okay.
There we go. And we'll go ahead and press continue here. So you'll see a couple of Rivian sensors right there. Just leave those alone. It needs to use Bluetooth for those. You'll see your name here.
Mm-hmm.
So tap your name on the screen. It recognizes that now, so it's going to send a signal to both screens.
Mm-hmm.
Press pair.
Press pair. Pair.
And there you go. So your phone is now paired.
Very good.
You can press continue. Do you use Alexa?
I don't have Alexa at the home, no.
Okay. For anyone in the audience who uses Alexa, it pairs with the same account you use inside.
Yeah.
You can either use that in this vehicle or you can skip. Confirm.
Yes.
Yep. Later. And this is how we protect your data. That's always available. You can just press done.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Your electric adventure starts now. Again.
It continues.
It continues. All right. Okay. So now we are officially in, and I may just answer your question about your wife's key real quick.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to set up a second phone key, you can do that in settings.
Mm-hmm. We go in settings.
And you go to drivers and keys.
Yep.
And then before you can make her name appear, you need to invite her.
Okay, you do that through the app.
You go ahead and go through the app.
All right.
Uh-huh.
And so then you would walk the same process.
She will have to accept the email invite,
and
then her name appears. But yeah, do it while she's in the vehicle.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so is that what you, because she has
to pair. The signal has to receive it from
Very
both
good.
Devices.
That works. All right, so now let's continue on as you would for showing somebody that's never been in a Rivian.
Well, the most important thing is climate.
Mm-hmm.
You got to be comfortable, right? Can't have everybody yelling at you.
Mm-hmm.
So to adjust the climate, you can just tap the blue or the red arrows.
Mm-hmm.
Really simple.
Up and down.
Yep. Yeah. And your passenger can too.
Yep.
So it's dual climate. Mm-hmm. And then if you want to adjust anything above and beyond just the heat and the cooling, press the number.
Mm-hmm.
And that brings up your climate screen.
Yep.
All right. So you see the different vents here. Mm-hmm. In order to change the direction of the air, just press and drag.
And one of the things I noticed, it's showing on my side air conditioning's on, but your side heat is on. So you can you can do it either way depending on how you set it. Everybody doesn't have to have the same type of you know climate coming
people
in.
People run hot.
Okay.
People run cold.
Yeah.
So yes, the dual air conditioning is nice.
And then this brings the lower.
Those are your feet vents.
Yeah. And then up here you tap that, and then it's for the windscreen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So okay, great.
And you can move it. This is how you move, you angle them.
Yep, you got
depending on where you want it, yeah.
Press
no,
and drag.
No, the bottom is on
Those
and off.
Those are just on and off.
Yep.
And you've got your cooled seats and heated seats. Your passenger has cooled and heated. You also have your steering wheel heating. And then this is where the R1S.
The fan settings. Yeah.
Yep, the fan settings are right there. A lot of people like to use auto.
Mm-hmm.
That just sets the temperature and forget it, you know, so you don't have to really constantly adjust. This is where the R1S differs from the R1T a little bit. You can have the middle and the back. So go ahead and hit the middle.
Absolutely.
And now you can control the folks' foot vents and their face
And their face, okay,
And they can move their stuff as well.
They have manual vents that they move,
Yes, it's right here above their screen.
Mm-hmm.
And from, you can also turn their heated seats on.
Okay.
Okay.
They don't get cooled seats, just heated. They're second class citizens.
You know.
And the third row gets nothing because they're third row seats.
If that's the way you want to put it, no. Yeah, these are the primo seats right here.
And what's this up in the right-hand corner?
Now, if you want to lock out their screen so they have no control over their heated seats or anything.
Let's go back. That timed out.
You can go back to your middle.
Oh, wait.
You can actually lock them out, so only you.
Yeah.
Maybe they're fighting over it.
Because they have a touchscreen in the back also that they can adjust their temperature
with.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
So then let's look at the back.
To be clear,
this is
they
new
cannot,
for me.
Yeah, and we'll show you this in a second. Yeah. To be clear, they can't adjust their temperature.
Okay.
Whatever you have up here
it's
on the
set there. Yeah, yeah. I forgot.
So they can see what it is, and they can complain to you if they have problems.
The funny thing is, I never sat in the back of my Rivian. I always saw the screen with the numbers there,
right.
And I didn't even realize that they couldn't adjust it. That I was the only one. Yep. I thought they could also.
They're just. It's just a. letting them know what they have to
deal
with.
What the temperature, what I've decided they should have in the back. Okay.
Yeah. But we all want to keep our passengers comfortable.
As it should be.
Yeah. All right,
okay, so
let's go
to the back. Yeah.
Third row. So remember those vents I showed you in the back? So there they are. You can turn them on or off.
Yeah.
Okay. It's just a one button situation, but it keeps them comfortable. You can increase or decrease.
And they don't get heated seats back there.
Right.
Yeah. So it really is a class system. You know, we get everything first class.
Hey, one, two,
second class,
ABC,
steerage.
I don't know. All right, so climate, you feel comfortable with climate?
Yeah, everything's good. We got
great.
That.
Great. So let's go Navi. That's your first icon right there. Perfect. And this has a really cool experience. We've designed this navigation specifically for our owners. What's special about it that maybe stands out from other navigation systems? It is connected to your vehicle, so it knows how much state of charge you have.
Yep.
And it will tell you, hey, if you're navigating to X location and you don't have enough, it's going to tell you where you're going to stop along the way so that you know you're never going to
be... And it tells you the remaining miles or state of charge at your arrival point.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So you're... And it works all of that into the ETA. So however long you have to stop at that station, it works that into your accurate ETA.
Yeah.
It accommodates for traffic. It uses Google data. So the two things mainly that people do with this are search for addresses and search for chargers.
Yeah.
To search for addresses, it's really simple. Tap the... magnifying glass, and then you would type in either a store name or an address,
and it'll pull it up. Or you could use the Alexa voice command.
Exactly.
You don't have to have an Alexa account to use the Alexa voice command here. You know.
Yeah.
It works because I don't have an Alexa account and I use it all the time with my with the R1T.
Right.
So the voice command still works, just not the integration.
Yep.
So
it just wouldn't connect to like an account. Okay, so you would search for addresses, pretty straightforward with all navigation systems.
Yeah. And then you could also go in here and look at the different points of interest, right? If you wanted to find a coffee shop, grocery shop,
it kind of just
restrooms,
looks right in
food.
Your area.
Yeah, and it looks right in the area. Okay.
So that's nice.
Cool.
So points of interest and then charging. Let's say you're anywhere and you want to find a public charger. You just press the lightning bolt down here in the bottom right, and you see the three filters.
Yep.
So now you can filter your search by those. But let's just leave them alone so it searches for everything.
Yeah.
All you got to do is zoom out.
Yep.
Okay, so you just keep zooming out and then let it process for a second and all those chargers will pop up.
Yep.
And if you'll notice, you've got some with one lightning bolt, some with two lightning bolts, some with three lightning bolts. That's a speed.
Okay.
So if you really want to fast, go to the three lightning bolts. And if you press it, it might give you some information.
Yep. 100 kilowatts. Yeah. So, but one thing I do want to clarify, I think some people think that means level one charging, one bolt, level two charging, two bolts, level three charging, three bolts. That's not how it works. The one bolt is for basically for level two charging. It could be level one also, but they're level one typically aren't listed here on this. So the single bolt is AC charging. Which the R1T and R1S can accept up to 11 kilowatts. And then the two bolts and the three bolts are for level three charging. Well, it's DC fast charging.
Right.
And it will, depending on how much power it can deliver, less than 100 kilowatts.
And you can see that in your speed filter.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there you go right there. So if it's level two charging, well, it says up to 25 kilowatts. That's what the stations can deliver, but the truck can only accept 11 and a half kilowatts.
Yeah, in our waypoints charging system, you know, it can have an optimized charging for the Rivian.
Yeah, okay. But DC fast, see two bars, it's 100 kilowatt, up to 100 kilowatt, and over 100 kilowatt, you'll have the three lightning bars there. So those are the ones, if you're on long trips, you really want to try to find the three bars. Two bars will be okay, but the three bars will really get you along your way a lot quicker.
Yep. Yep, you really just have to kind of stop for...
And you can filter out. I forgot to mention that. So let's say we only want to see the three bars. See, there you go. And now let's say, okay, I'll do the two bars also. then one just popped up, or a couple of just popped up. You know, if you could say, look, I don't want to see level two, because when you're on a long road trip, you really don't want to see level two, unless you're staying overnight in a hotel.
Yeah.
So this is what you'd have it set at, and that way you could see where the fast chargers are. Okay.
Very cool.
Next up.
Yep. So, yeah, and you can also filter by availability, like which ones actually have plugs available. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we have that information. You mm-hmm. know, we try to give everything that we possibly can.
Yeah, it depends if they're networked. Yeah.
Exactly.
So, and then
the network is the other option. Yeah. And so these are the networks we search for in here. And mm-hmm. again, the Tesla, I'm not sure if our team is only showing Tesla chargers mm-hmm. that are with that plug.
I can tell you in a second. I know where they are. Let's see. You see, right now, you would see a lot of Tesla supercharging stations, but you don't. And so let's see. They haven't been integrated yet because the Tesla, the Tesla chargers with the magic dock, you would see populated right here. So it has it there, but they haven't made it work yet.
Yeah, and our team is especially with this new information, probably constantly evaluating and updating. Yeah. And that's a good bridge, obviously, to the software update, mm-hmm. which is a big feature for an EV owner.
Okay.
This is software.
Yeah.
So what's cool is you get the newest software over the air delivered whenever we have an update.
Yeah, I had a few updates with the R1T, so
It fixes bugs, mm-hmm. It obviously provides new features, so as the EV world expands, we keep up with it, and so do you
as the
owner. All right, so and then you just tap the lightning bolt to take it off.
And one last thing to point out, if you want to have the view of, the overhead view rather than the regular map, you'd click on the world view there, and that's when you get the
satellite view.
Satellite view, yeah, that's the word I was trying to search for. Okay, cool.
Some people have small preferences, like they always want the map north up.
Yeah.
So that's a settings right mm-hmm. here, and you can see right now north is up, but some people prefer the 3D, and there's different variations there.
Yeah.
So that's Navi. Now music is right here, that's the next icon, and these are your music listening options over here. We've got a few apps that are integrated. So depending on whatever you use for music listening, like some people use Spotify, mm-hmm. you can log into your account right here, and boom, it's integrated, so you can just control your entire experience from the screen.
Yep.
And then we have TuneIn, we have Tidal, and then we have up top radio, FM radio. And then for other people who use, let's say, iTunes or Amazon Music, any mm-hmm. other music app, you just choose the phone. And then you can control it from your phone.
Yep.
Now, the basic controls like play and pause and mm-hmm. next and previous, that can be controlled from here. Mm-hmm. It can even be controlled from your steering wheel. But otherwise, the interface in your phone. Is what you'd use. We even have an equalizer down here.
That's where you set everything up.
Yeah. That's where you set everything up. So you can adjust your preferences. You even have like genres up here mm-hmm. in the top right for your preference. Everything. But the speaker system is outstanding and it's awesome.
Yeah. Okay. Very good.
Okay.
Let's go into drive modes.
Yeah. So drive modes is also here. So that's the third icon. And there they are. So there's your drive modes. You got all purpose, mm-hmm. sport. Now sport is going to, or all purpose, I'm sorry, is what we're going to mm-hmm. want, you to do every day. It's what we recommend. It has great efficiency, great performance. You're going to get the most out of your vehicle in most terrains. Mm-hmm.
That's how I drove the R1T almost all the time in all-purpose mode.
Yeah, it feels good.
Yeah.
Sport, if you really want to go, and this will lower the ride height.
Is it safe? Yeah, are there any cats under? There's no animals under there right now? Let's lower the ride height. So in sport mode, it drops it down.
You might see the roof lowering slightly.
It's dropping. You could hear it, too.
The hood, yeah. So anyway, this goes to the lowest ride height possible. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, there's 9.5 inches of ground clearance. Mm-hmm. So that's the lowest that this vehicle offers. And it goes all the way up to 15 inches of ground clearance in off-road mode. Mm-hmm. So it's a nice range that air suspension gives you. One tip about conserve. Mm-hmm. Conserve mode is really only recommended when you are low on battery. Mm-hmm. A lot of people notice that conserve is attractive because it extends your range. So if you go ahead and press conserve, mm-hmm. notice your range increasing.
Yep.
That's tempting to be in conserve all the time. Mm-hmm. Here's why I don't recommend that. We have some people come into our service center and they're like seeing that their wheels in the front are worn down. And they're frustrated.
Yeah.
The reason why is because they've been driving in conserve for, let's say, 6 or 7 months straight.
Yeah.
And it's only a two-wheel mode.
Yep. You're running front-wheel drive. It decouples the rear motors and makes the drivetrain more efficient.
Exactly. Yeah.
But how about this? I'm going on a long road trip. You know, I always drive in all-purpose mode, but today I'm going to drive to Florida. Okay. And I want to go as far as I can between charges. Would you not recommend running in conserve mode on that one trip?
Or I would recommend not going into conserve mode when you're off the highway. Here's why. When you're braking, that's when this, you know, 7,000 to 8,000 pound vehicle is putting all its weight on two tires.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you're braking, like if you're off the highway and you're kind of doing, I would not be in conserve.
Okay.
Now,
but,
look.
But just on the highway for the long drive, it's okay.
Yeah.
Just, you know, then go back into all purpose. Don't just leave it in conserve mode all the time.
Okay. Exactly.
All right. Yeah. Because it sounded at first as if you were kind of recommending don't use it at all. If you want to use it to extend your range on highway drives, when you need it, not every day when you go on highway drives,
right.
But
if you know you're on Florida,
yeah. Because I've used it when I've done range tests with my Rivian, and it makes a noticeable difference. The vehicle's a lot more efficient in conserve mode.
Absolutely.
On the highway, yeah. But off,
primarily because it's in two-wheel drive mode.
Yeah.
And so you don't want to put all that pressure onto the front wheels. I'm just trying to keep people from...
Yeah, from wearing out their front tires.
Yep.
And not understand that's how it works is what we're saying here.
Exactly.
Use conserve mode sparingly when you need it on long drives. Don't just leave the vehicle in conserve mode all the time, because what you're going to do is you're going to end up prematurely wearing your tires. And the money you saved on you being more efficient in the vehicle, saving a few bucks on electricity will cost you hundreds of dollars in tires. So that's the lesson here.
Exactly. Now, snow mode is an awesome mode, especially for first-time EV owners who are not used to that regenerative braking. Regenerative braking is when you lift your foot off the accelerator pedal and it feels like braking. This vehicle has regenerative braking, so it's kind of like one-pedal driving. And snow mode is the only mode that offers low regenerative braking, or it's the lightest aggressive feel. So you don't necessarily have to be in snow to drive in snow mode. It just supports that lower regenerative braking.
The reason why it has that is because if you're on snow and icy roads, if you have very strong regen, it could create a slipping surface.
Yep.
A slipping surface. So I understand why it has that. That's great. Yeah.
Off-road mode.
Yeah.
Now this is going to ask you if you want to go up. So go ahead and press go off-road.
Yeah.
And now this will use
now
the air
we're
suspension.
Going up. Yeah.
We're sailing, baby.
Yeah.
So this will go to 15 inches of ground clearance, which is the highest in the industry from the factory.
And then there's also, once you're in off-road mode, now you have all-terrain choice. You've got soft sand, rock crawl, rally, and drift modes, okay? So you got a lot of options here.
A lot of different terrains.
Yeah.
Okay? And so I don't know if a lot of people know this, but when we first started, we were a sports performance company, sports car company.
Car, yeah.
And so we built our first prototype. It was a hybrid sports car. When we pivoted to electric adventure, which was a smart pivot, we didn't want to lose any of the fun performance aspects. So this is a lot of the fun you can have, and especially in sport mode as well.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Very cool. Okay. So and then there's also towing mode. Check your trailer connected. We don't need to drop it into that, but can you tell a little bit about what towing mode does?
Of course, yeah. Yes, with towing, you've got trailer braking. For anyone who's towing, it's got the standard trailer braking. It's got the hitch. As long as you're attached, you just go to tow mode and you're set.
You're good. Okay, cool. Now, I notice on the bottom here, you can adjust your ride, the regenerative braking, and your stability control. You can turn it on and off, right?
You've got three characteristics.
So this is soft and stiff for the ride, I guess, depending on what you prefer. And then here, regenerative braking, it's standard and high. And then, as you mentioned earlier, for snow mode, it was low, but you don't have a choice. You can't put it on low if you're not in snow mode. So, standard and high, I'm going to drop it on high. I like driving in high, and actually, I'm going to put this back on soft because I prefer soft. With high regen, we leave the stability control on. That's where you would turn it off. Oh, no, and also reduced. So if you want to play with your stability control, you could do that there. Most people are just going to leave it on. I recommend, unless you know what you're doing and you really want to play around with the vehicle, just leave the stability control on. And then coming over here to the ride height, you can adjust that yourself. Now, it will automatically change depending on what
mode
you're in. But then, at least I know in all-purpose mode, let's drop it in all-purpose. Now it's going to go back to standard. But if you wanted to leave it in high, you could press it, right?
And, that's right.
you know, is it safe to, well, to hit lower for some reason?
Well, it's kind of lowering from the off-road mode right now.
I got you.
So it's continuing to lower.
Okay, yeah, I went too fast. So, lower. But if, and now it's going up to high. So you could manually set it to the height that you want. But it's going to automatically drop it in an appropriate height that it thinks, depending on which mode you're in.
Yeah, if you don't want to worry about manually setting the height, mm-hmm. you can just press auto.
Yeah, okay.
And it will recognize various factors that will either raise it or lower it. You really won't feel it. Yeah. You know, it's cool. Just optimizing for range and performance.
Very good. All right, let's check out the next icon.
Amazing. Yeah, so these are just some controls.
Yeah.
So you might want to fold your mirrors, you know, those right here.
Yeah, you want to fold your motor. Well, it will automatically fold, though. We could do that in the settings.
Yes.
But yeah, that's just to manually do it.
You can open your hood right from here, your charge port, get it all going. These are just some controls. You can control these from your app as mm-hmm. well.
Okay, lock and unlock. Open the lift gate. But it doesn't close, it just opens, so I'm not going to do that now.
Well, the lift gate is different than the tailgate. Remember, it's a split?
Yeah.
So the lift gate will automatically open and close.
From here, you can close it.
Yes.
I didn't realize that. I thought when I did the first media drive, I thought it didn't close. I thought you could only open it from here. Okay, cool.
You definitely can open and close it from there.
This is important.
Yes, I was going to say that. So if you press the I, this will tell you what car wash mode does. Mm-hmm. If you're going through a car wash in this type of vehicle, you know, it's going to maybe have some audible mm-hmm. warnings. It's going to accidentally open the charge port door, mm-hmm. whatever it may be.
I put it in car wash mode.
So now
I pressed it twice. Look, it's closing the windows.
We're getting ready to car wash.
Yeah.
you shouldn't have to car wash it yet on day one.
Yeah.
No, so this just obviously makes sure that the sensors are desensitized and it can go through a car wash.
Let's get out of there. Yeah, and because, for instance, the charge port. If you were running through a car wash and the brush hit that little, the three lines, the charge port door might open and the car wash would pull it off. So it might hit the button in the front and slap it and the hood opens up or the automatic wipers. So this powers all that stuff down.
Yeah.
So, that's good. That's a good feature.
Before I go into the security system, we do have light preferences mm-hmm. over here. So if you prefer this screen to be light all the time or dark all the time or automatic, right? There's default settings.
Yeah. Open with door. Yeah, basic what you can get in most vehicles. But that's where you adjust all your interior lights.
Your preferences. Yeah. And then this is just your specs for your vehicle, your mm-hmm. VIN and all that stuff, your mm-hmm. mileage.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what really, let me go back into that. So this is, there's two trip gauges for the R1T and R1S. Trip A, and it'll show you, you know, how much total energy you've used. The total distance you've driven. Wow, this thing used 151 kilowatt hours and only 28 miles. What kind of consumption am I going to get?
Well, these are significant. We're testing your vehicle.
I don't know how you were testing it.
We want to make sure this thing is ready to rock.
I'm going to reset that now. But what I'm going to reset this. I didn't want to because I usually like to leave the original trip, but this will throw off my overall consumption. See, it's showing less than 1 mile per kilowatt hour. That must have been from testing the vehicle. We must have had it on, running things and everything. So let's reset this now. But now my trip B is always going to be 28 miles behind the total vehicle miles. So, but that I leave because I like to have an overall consumption rate for my vehicles a year or two whenever I sell it. Yeah, I always like to reference that.
That's so, great.
I'm glad I picked that up now before I drove it much. So, mm-hmm. okay, we'll go back to what you...
Yep. Okay, so this is our security system. It's called Gear Guard. Yep. Right now, it's not turned on. If you were to turn it on, it would activate whenever anyone gets close to the vehicle. Someone gets close to the vehicle, it will turn on the security cameras on the outside of your vehicle and capture the activity, mm-hmm. and it will be there in videos for you.
And so, then it notifies you. When you arrive back to your vehicle, this little bell here will have a little yellow dot on it, and it tells you that we recorded an event, so you can watch it there. You can't watch it while you're driving your car. I've tried. You shouldn't watch video while you're driving, but you have to be in park for it to work. But it's good. It has the cameras all around the vehicle. Somebody messes with your car, if they swing their door open and ding your car, you've got it all captured. So that works well. The only thing it doesn't do, which I wish it did, was I wish when it was capturing a video, you got an alert on your phone. Because let's say you're in a restaurant and somebody's messing with your car, it would be nice if it gave you an alert and you can go out and see it. And that, the way it is now, you get out to your car and you're like, oh, wait a minute, there was an event. And now you see somebody backed into your car and crunched their tail right at your headlight. But anyway, I know that's not
your
gig.
I will take that back.
It'd be nice to get a nice little alert, you know?
Yep. So, anyway. I hear you. So yeah, that's how you would turn that on. And so that's gear guard. Mm-hmm. Definitely okay. Recommend.
All right. We'll go into settings is next.
Yeah, settings. This is similar to any device you might buy. Yeah. You want to set all your personal preferences. Mm-hmm. So the main area you do that is under vehicle and access.
Yep.
So right here is where you can kind of, whenever you press unlock, do you want it to unlock all the doors or just the driver door? You know, that's a preference. Same with when you put it in park. Do you want it to unlock all the doors when you put it in park or just the driver door? There's a lot of different things on here. I think the most contentious ones are the ones that, you know, really get turned on and off frequently. Proximity locking.
Yeah.
That's when you approach your vehicle with a key in your pocket. Mm-hmm. It automatically unlocks. Some people like that. Some people don't.
Yeah.
And then the kneeling feature. The kneeling feature lowers the vehicle once you put it in park to provide a little bit easier entry exit.
Yeah, and that's important. And that was added as an over-the-air update when I had my R1T. Yeah. And that was a problem because I take my parents around. My parents are older. And for them getting in and out of the vehicle, I had to keep putting it into the lowest setting. Every time we got out, it was a hassle. Now it kneels down, so we have easier entry. Yeah, I wish this vehicle had running boards. That would make it a lot easier. I think I might even put aftermarket running boards on, but that's another story. Because my parents actually asked me to drive in my Lightning over the R1T when I would drive them around because they can step on the running boards and get in. And this didn't have a running board option. I think Rivian's working on that, but as of now, there's no running board option.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's...
I can neither confirm nor deny any
understand.
Of that information.
Yeah, I understand.
But no,
that.
I hear you, and that's very important. We're very good, I think, at listening and responding. Yeah. So...
Yeah, that would be big, running boards as an option. You should offer that.
Taking it back, Tom. All right. Thank you. All right. And then one thing a lot of people like to do is at their state of charge, which is in the bottom right of their driver screen, some people like to see a percentage.
Yes.
Not just a mileage number.
How do you do
that?
So
right there, you go to units and then scroll down and then you can have range.
Yep.
Do both as well.
Yep. That's actually how I run with it. I want more information, the better.
Yep.
I want, and you can adjust to PSI or whatever, Fahrenheit, miles per hour. Yep. This is all, freedom units and
so the only other thing I might tell you is the three dots here. Go ahead and press the three dots and we go to, we have owner's guide, settings, phone, camping, gear guard, energy, and cameras. Cameras is fun. You got a front view camera.
Got the overhead view over here.
You got the overhead view.
Which you can change to the side views.
Right.
Yeah.
This is for curb parking. Makes it easier to parallel park without, hitting
and
the curb.
And also off-roading so you don't you blow out a tire on a sharp rock or something like that. You could watch as you're going. Yeah.
We got cameras right there for you.
If you press it again, you get the overhead bird's eye view. There's always a drone flying over your Rivian. So
constantly.
So wherever you are, it can give you the bird's eye view of the truck.
It's like a little partner. No, they use the cameras on the outside of the vehicle to stitch them and calibrate them together to make
it's a drone up there.
Let's keep with that story. That's a fun one. And then you got the rear camera by toggling back.
Front. You can go front and rear.
It's nice that you have all the control
with
the cameras, And of course, whenever you put into reverse, it automatically goes into the rear view. And also in the three dots, you have your owner's guide. We don't give you a glove compartment up
here.
We wanted to provide more leg room for everybody. And we have this really deep center console.
Yeah, you press a button.
Yeah, you just press a button and anything you'd want to put in there. Yeah.
And there's two USB-C ports in there.
That's correct, two USB-C ports there. But we don't give you a big book owner's guide. Why? Because we're updating things all the time. So we just give you a digital owner's guide that is incredibly useful when it comes to intuitive searching and anything you may want to look into. For folks who like camping, I think this is really cool. Sometimes you're parked on a campground, it's uneven surface. If you go into camp mode, you can level the SUV.
That's
so if
cool.
you want to sleep in the back and stuff, you don't want to be rolling over to the left and the right. So this will level the vehicle using the air suspension no matter what type of surface you're on.
Yeah, and that's also something that came as an OTA update. When I got my R1T, it didn't have it,
right?
But then it had it. So that's one of the cool things about Rivian and some of the other new vehicles. They get better as you own them. Like, you know, all of a sudden, 6 months later, you get an update on a feature that you didn't have when you bought it. So right. They're basically giving you something like, oh, by the way, you know, we're going to make your vehicle better over the years rather than it getting worse. So that's really cool.
Yep. Obviously, the body will look the same.
Yeah.
But hopefully, you know, this stays relevant for a long time.
How about these camp courtesy and floodlights?
Yeah, these are just options for you when you're at the campground. Sometimes mm-hmm. you need to provide brighter lights for maybe cooking and whatnot. Mm-hmm. You've got the floodlights.
Okay.
Yeah, and sometimes you just want to turn your display off.
Yeah.
So you can actually manually do that, kind of put it to sleep.
Yeah, if you don't want, sometimes you're sitting in the vehicle and you just want it to be dark, you know.
Yeah. And also, often you want to plug in at campsites, so you do need to turn your vehicle's outlets on.
Right, and where are the outlets? We saw one in the back.
Yes.
Where are there other outlets?
The one is in the back, and then the one is right here under the climate screen.
So there's two outlets. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. And well, one last thing, when you put the outlets on, the most you could leave them on is for 24 hours, they'll turn off. Having them on, the inverters draws constant energy. And also, you know, if you're not using them, there's no reason to leave them on.
Exactly. So,
yeah. Okay.
And I think that's a fair point for anyone who's new to EV driving, like how much reduction in range does various things have? Everything impacts range.
Yeah.
You know, similar to a gas-powered vehicle, if you're towing something, it's going to reduce the range. Well, same with the electric vehicles. So, like, if you have a lot of weight in the vehicle, it reduces the range. If you're blasting the AC, it reduces the range. Yeah.
So if you have the suspension up to the highest level versus the lowest on long highway drives, more air resistance.
Yes.
So,
aggressive driving, right? Everything impacts range. So you always just want to be cognizant of your range. Even the weather outside sometimes, if it's extremely cold or extremely hot, that can impact the range.
Okay.
Cool.
Where are we at? Let me see.
I think we're golden. If you want to go through energy.
Yeah, I just want to show people that, because this is an important screen.
This is state of charge stuff right here.
With electric vehicles, this is super important. So here's actually how another place where you turn the accessory power on. And also you want to set your charging limit. They had it set to 100% because they obviously set it to 100%. To charge it up, they want to give me the vehicle pretty much fully charged, 95%. But most people are going to set it there. You don't want to charge your electric vehicle, depending on the EV. Some vehicles you can charge 100%, particularly with the newer LFP battery packs. But most all electric vehicles, you don't want to charge 100% daily charging unless you need the extra range. If you need the extra range, that's fine. But for daily charging, 85% is a sweet spot. And that's why Rivian has these different set points here. So that's what we recommend you do. You can set charging schedule up here. If you have time of use plans where you pay less for your electricity overnight, you would set that all in there. It doesn't have scheduled departure, which I'm a little disappointed. Hopefully that's going to be something that comes in an OTA update where you can set the vehicle to say, look, I need to leave at 8 o'clock in the morning, have my vehicle fully charged by 8 o'clock, and also precondition the battery so it's all warmed up and ready to go at 8 o'clock. Rivian doesn't offer that yet. There's another feedback thing that I hope they do. That's one of the things that my Lightning has, which really helped in the winter extend its range because I could set my departure time with scheduled preconditioning. The battery's warm, the cabin's warm, I'm at 100%. So that's a little feedback.
Definitely we'll take that. And also when you precondition the vehicle, because you can precondition the vehicle manually. I hear that maybe you want to set it as a specific time to automatically do it.
Yeah.
But if you were up in the house and you preconditioned the vehicle from inside, it will warm the battery up and warm the cabin up.
Yeah.
But you'd have to do it manually at this time.
It really
time.
Doesn't stay on long enough to warm the battery up. In my opinion, it really is meant for cabin preconditioning because on a really cold day, if this parked outside, the preconditioning might have to be on for like an hour to get the battery warmed enough where it helps. And I've just found that the app, it just doesn't, it's not good enough. You should be able to set scheduled.
Yeah.
One last thing over here, if you put your leg back a little bit, we have the charging amperage. The Rivian vehicles can accept up to 48 amps. That's about 11.5 kilowatts. If you want to charge at a lower rate, or if you're on a charger, let's say that hasn't been installed properly and you can overdraw the circuit. It shouldn't be the case. If it's all done properly, the charger will be on a circuit that can only deliver the maximum power that the charger can deliver. But if you think that there's a problem with overdrawing a circuit, you can do this here. You can lower this down to say, okay, you know, I'll charge at 30 amps today. And some people just like doing it anyway because they charge overnight and they're like, there's no reason to really charge their vehicle that quickly. By the morning, it's always going to be fully charged. And by charging it at a slower rate, it's a little bit easier on my battery. For level two charging, I don't really think that that's a case, but some people might have a different opinion. You could lower it here and I'm going to go back up to 48 because I want to charge this thing as fast as possible. I think it should also have an 80 amp onboard charger like the Lightning does. Such a big battery pack, 135 kilowatt hour. We should be pulling 17, 18 kilowatts here on AC charging, but I'm not going to beat up Anthony about that either. And hey, that man, can't get done with an over-the-air update. That would need different hardware. But my prediction is Rivian will offer that as an option within 2 years. So, but let's see. Anyway, okay, let's move on.
Always
we're
growing.
We're getting really long here.
This is great.
Anything else that we wanted to touch on over here? I think, you know, we covered most of it.
We really covered a lot. Now, I just try to do actually everything.
Well,
so obviously you've
here.
Got your defrost in your front and your rear. But no, that's...
One last thing I want to point out on the driver's display. So the way it is now, if you could see on the left-hand side of the driver's display, it's on nav. There's two other screens you can scroll to. By holding this left button down, you can use the monitoring. Tire pressure monitoring. Right now it's saying nothing because you need to drive a little bit. You press down again and you get your efficiency. And what it does is it gives you your driving efficiency for the last 15 minutes. There's nothing there right now because you haven't been driving it at all. So once I drive, that'll come up there. I usually leave it on the efficiency.
Me too.
Because to me, that's, you know, that's the most usable thing. I don't, sometimes when I'm on nav, when I'm going somewhere, it's nice to have that also. I don't have to look over here to the nav, but I like that feature that you can scroll through those three different options to have displayed on the left-hand side of
right.
the screen.
And some people ask about the autonomous driving.
Yeah, let's the Driver Plus system.
That's
correct. Let's talk a little bit about that really quickly.
Driver Plus is what we call our autonomous driving system. It allows you to adapt your speed to the car in front of you once you engage it. And if you you can engage it by pressing on your drive stock downward once you're driving. And it adapts to the car in front of you. It can slow all the way down to zero. So if you're in traffic, you really can just, you know, take the ride. As long as it has information on the road, like the lines in the road and everything, it will indicate that you can go into the lane keep. And if you get that indication, you can go ahead and trigger it. It's the same stock. You just trigger it down again.
Yeah, push it twice quickly.
Yep.
And now you're in lane keep and adaptive cruise control.
And so you don't have to actively steer.
But it is not a hands-off system.
It is not
You have to keep your hands on, but it'll steer for you. Or, you know, if you just tug on it every now, you can hold it very lightly. Just tug on it every now and then. It'll let you know you're there.
It needs your warmth.
Yeah, it wants to know that you haven't fallen asleep with your hands off.
Yeah.
And so it actually works pretty well, too. I use it a lot with my R1T, and you disable it by pushing up on it. Once down does the adaptive cruise control, twice down quickly, and then on pre-mapped roads. The roads have to be pre-mapped.
It needs information from the roads.
Yeah, which is, I found, most of the highways around here. It's not for use on secondary and tertiary roads. This is a highway driver assist system. So there's some other systems out there that'll work on other roads. The Rivian Driver Plus really only works on highways and pre-mapped roads.
It's something that we're doing extensive testing on and certainly want to provide as much value in that regard as possible, but safety is the number one thing.
Yeah.
We just got rated the Top Safety Pick Plus Award from IIHS, which is the most rigorous standards and the most rigorous testing. So you're driving the safest vehicle
very good
in the industry.
Let's, before we go, there's another feature that the truck has that's really cool. It's the down here?
The Rivian Camp Speaker.
Yes.
The removable Bluetooth speaker.
So once you pull that out
underneath the center console, You've got a removable Bluetooth speaker you can bring right into your home or put it on the tailgate and hang out with your refrigerator and your drinks.
And it's cool. I use that a lot with my R1T.
How's the quality?
Really cool. Oh, excellent. It's got really cool LED lighting around the base. So when it's dark out, the whole base lights up. And you got to pair it with your phone. And, you know, actually all my friends had it paired with their phones. So now that I got a new vehicle, they're going to have to repair it because we're hanging out. Like, they wanted to have control of it. So, and it's always charged. It's constantly charging under there. Like the flashlight that I should have had, it's always ready whenever you want to use it.
It is an absolutely great quality speaker. Yeah. And it charges in there 6.5 hours of battery life.
That's really cool.
Love
it. And the sound quality is great.
Yeah. So, yeah. So,
what do you think? Anything else we need to cover? I think we pretty much covered everything.
Man, I feel like I'm, you know, just ready for like a long drive, you know?
Yeah, I think that's in store for me today. I want to check out this guy. One last thing I want to mention that we didn't mention earlier when you said there's no glove compartment. We have the center console here, but also underneath both seats, you pull them down and there's little compartments there, which are really good for like sunglasses and things like that. I always put them,
gum.
I always put that stuff under there. So that was good. And got the deep pockets on the side of the doors. And
one thing that everybody loves is because there's no transmission box here, this is just open. So especially the ladies who are driving this, they can put whatever bag, however they want to use this open space is.
And on the center console, there's a little mat here, and that's the wireless charging port, which doesn't work well. I'm going to make another criticism. As soon as you accelerate, your phone moves, it disconnects. And I can't get mine to work. When you drop down, it works fine. Watch, it's going to connect.
Yeah, it connects.
And it didn't. There you go. But as soon as you move, it shuts off.
I know.
And, so I always use the USB-C plug inside here.
I always use the USB-C.
Yeah, so I mean, they can improve that.
Yes, I hear you. Yeah. I totally hear you. Yep, you got to make sure that that doesn't move. And some people like to use this area as kind of a phone stand.
Yeah,
if you like
What they should do, some cars have drop-in wireless phone chargers, and it holds the phone. If Rivian re-engineered that and had it, even if it was sideways, where you drop it in there, and then it charged, it would hold it, and I think that'd be a huge improvement in my opinion. So, but you know, I'm nitpicking here,
but that's what I do.
Good. I nitpick.
It's fantastic.
So, all right, listen, that was fantastic. Thank you so much. I think this went really well. I'm pretty sure that my followers are gonna think that you know, you did a great job. You had a, you had a tough act to follow.
Sade did. Oh my gosh!
Awesome job with
Sade.
My R1T.
Sade is outstanding. Yeah. Sade and I were one of the first folks to deliver vehicles out of the Brooklyn Service Center, which was one of the first delivery centers. Yeah. And she has been.
Is she still with
outstanding.
Rivian?
Oh, okay. She's.
Because I was kind of expecting her to come back. But
she's
but
fantastic.
You lived up to you carried.
I don't know
the
what
torch.
She's doing today. I didn't actually see her yet, so maybe she's off today or something.
She was probably like, I don't want to deal with that guy again. Anthony, you go. He
had
me there for 2 hours.
No, it was great to meet you, and I'm happy. I don't expect to get the comments that Sade got.
Oh, she was.
I was even in the comments.
She got rock star comments.
she is a rock star.
They were like, RJ, give her a raise.
She's awesome.
Yeah, she did helps. A great. But I have to tell you, you did a fantastic job here today.
Thanks.
I'm sure, you know, you might not get the love that she got, because I think people were surprised at how good it was.
Yeah.
And now they're kind of like, well, the bar's here, so, well, yeah, he did a good job, but he should. You know, she did a good job last time. So,
it's awesome. Yeah. It's a great company to work for, and it's an awesome product to be a part of.
Awesome. Listen, thanks for your time. I appreciate it. I'm looking forward to getting this guy out and seeing if it, you know, if I'm as happy with it as I was with my R1T. I love my R1T, but I don't need two pickup trucks, and I have the Lightning, and I really love the Lightning. I'm going to keep the Lightning, and now we've got the SUV and the pickup truck thing going. I think that's a good blend for the family.
Well, we hope to see you around, man.
Thank you very much. Oh, you will. You'll hear a lot from me, too.
Good.
A lot of reviews coming up on the Rivian R1S. So, but I don't know. Should I wait to get my flashlight before I start doing any content for Rivian? You know, I also want a charger.
It won't take long. I promise you that.
I've been asking Rivian to send me their level 2 home charger for a while so I can review it. And for some reason, they just won't send me one. So I might have to buy one. Now, I'm not saying that'll influence my review because I'm honest, but all the companies send me the chargers to review, and Rivian for some reason has not. And a lot of people are asking, Tom, have you reviewed that charger yet? So that review is coming up soon, whether I have to buy one or they provide me one on media loan. Either way, I'm going to be reviewing the Rivian charger coming up soon, along with tons of content on the Rivian R1S. All right, so that's pretty much it. I really appreciate you coming out. This was fantastic. And listen, keep up the good work. Keep delivering those vehicles. And good luck to Rivian.
Thank you. You too.
Okay. Listen, if this is your first time here at State of Charge, don't forget to smash that subscribe button so you don't miss any upcoming electric vehicle news and reviews. And as always, thanks for watching.